is the University of Michigan.
Touchdown, Michigan!
And the court extra pass.
And it goes for the win! The three-pointer by Jordan Poole!
Down the sideline! Peoples Jones! Touchdown, Wolverine!
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Saturday Six Pack. I am Jack here with Roe. This is going to be a new segment that we're going to be trying out as a branch off from the Blue by 90 podcast. We're just going to have a couple guys on here, just drink some beers and talk sports, talk local Ann Arbor favorites, and get a little taste of everything. So, Ro, what are you drinking over there?
I have a Bell's Official. This is probably one of my favorite beers, definitely my favorite IPA. So, local here in Michigan, of course, Bell's is a great brewery.
Oh yeah, I've got my Bell's Oberon Koozie. Had to take that off.
All right,
but I'm with you. I like those hazy beers. So I got a Bloodlust hazy IPA from Rockford Brewing Company.
Rockford. Oh, okay. All right, I like
pretty solid. Picked it up yesterday. Wanted to try something new. The blood orange got me, and the hazy got me. So.
Blood orange is, I mean, I'm a big blood orange guy too. So is that Rockford, Michigan or Rockford, Illinois?
I'm going to assume Rockford, Michigan, but it should say on here. Michigan.
All right. There you go.
It's in the Rockford Brewing Company. It's in Comstock Park. So it's right next to Bell's.
Comstock.
Is that two different places?
Those are two different places. Yes, actually.
Okay.
Yeah. Comstock Park, so that's where, over by where I grew up, Rockford was actually my high school's biggest rival growing up. So I hated the Rockford Rams growing up at Hudsonville. So, but I'll support any local brewery as long as they put out good beers.
So. Yes, that's for sure. Well, cool. So we can kind of dive into this Saturday Six Pack. Another thing with this show, you may see me again, you may see Kalen, you may see Nate. We'll try to switch it up weekly, but we'll make it kind of a more relaxed podcast where it's not always Michigan football and we can kind of jump into some other things. So, Ro, I know you got some questions. So if you want to lead off with your first question for me, and then we can kind of go back and forth.
Yeah, for sure. So what we'll try to do here is with the Saturday Six Pack, we'll pick six topics. If you guys have questions out there that you want to send us or topics you would like to hear us discuss, feel free to send it in on our Instagram or at blueby90@gmail.com. But we've come up with a couple questions and topics for today here. The first one has nothing to do with Michigan athletics, but Jack and I both are in the Ann Arbor area. So my first question for you is, what is your favorite Ann Arbor restaurant? And then what is your favorite Ann Arbor bar? They can be the same thing if applicable, but if they're separate as well, that works too.
So that's a tough one because I'm going to try to keep breweries out of it because honestly, my favorite restaurant or bar that I would pick would be Wolverine State Brewing Company. But if we're going to stick strictly to restaurants, I'm going to say... And I'm going to pick a place that's not so, not your typical restaurant. Have you ever had Ricewood Barbecue?
I have not, no.
Oh, man. Okay, so next, when everything reopens, we're going to have to go there. So do you know where Morgan and York is across from Frazier's?
Yes, yep.
So Ricewood Barbecue, Frank is a buddy of mine. He and his brother Gabe, as well as Billy. They have basically a barbecue spot. It was voted best barbecue in Michigan. And what they do is like rice bowls. So they have sandwiches, they have rice bowls. You can get a brisket rice bowl, pulled pork, any sort of spice level on there. But I swear to you, it's the best barbecue I've ever had. I went down to Austin for a convention for Orange Theory. And apparently the number one barbecue spot in either America or the world is there. And we had that. And I preferred Ricewood. I preferred Ricewood. So that's like my go-to favorite meal. If I had to pick one that I had to eat for the rest of my life, that would be it. I'd go there.
Wow. Okay, well, that's high praise there. So definitely, we'll have to, maybe we'll host a podcast from there one time. But we'll once everything opens up, we'll have to go and get some grub there. All right, I'll give you my favorite restaurant, and then we can go bars too. So you know, obviously there is a very famous place in Ann Arbor, and probably what it's most famous for is Zingerman's Deli, right? Well, I actually prefer Zingerman's Roadhouse. So they have a restaurant out on Jackson Road. Instead of the deli, it's an actual sit-down restaurant, and it is unbelievable. So that's what I would pick out there. If you want to talk about barbecue, it's phenomenal barbecue as well. Mac and cheese, tons of different plates. But just a cool spot, and they have a kind of a drive-through camper outside too that you can come up to as well. So love that place. That's probably my favorite Ann Arbor restaurant.
So I've been there maybe like twice. One time was with Brooke and Mara, naturally. When was I not ever doing stuff with them? So and I actually saw Mike Tirico there.
Really?
There.
Okay.
Yeah.
Ann Arbor native. Yep.
Yep. And I was like, I couldn't like think of his name right when I saw him. And I was like, okay, I know this guy works for ESPN or some sports channel. So like I'm looking it up. I couldn't figure it out. Like once we leave, I figured it out. I was like, oh, it's Mike Tirico. So naturally I Googled him. And turns out he lives in Ann Arbor or Saline area. I had no idea. But I had been there. It's very good. I do like Zingerman's Roadhouse. That's a good spot. For bar. Let's go to the bars.
So we've been to the bars. We've been to the bars together a few times.
So if I can, I guess if I could divvy it up between college and like my adult life. Man, that's tough because there's two college bars that I really like for two separate reasons. Skeeps, obviously.
I knew you were going to say Skeeps.
You just go there, you get blackout. They play great music. I mean, I've very rarely had a bad time at Skeeps.
That's true.
Except when I was sober. I went there sober one time. It was the worst experience of my life. People just you don't realize it when you're drinking. Like people are stepping on you, like pushing you. Like, I could not stand it. I have a funny story about the Penn State loss at Skeeps. I was there watching it. But we'll skip over that for now. So Skeeps is up there. Okay. And then, Blue Lep was another good one in college. I like Blue Lep.
For me, South U was pretty much the spot to be. Although I've been to Skeeps my fair share as well on Tuesdays, you know, Tequila Tuesdays. And I can't even at 27 years old even imagine going out on a Tuesday at this point and waking up on, you know, early for anything on the next morning. I would say I stuck on a South U most of the time. In college, the Jug was my home base at all times, the Brown Jug. So that was I knew every bartender, every bouncer, every waiter and waitress. Like it was knowing them was actually part of the reason why I got in maybe before I was 21 a couple times, allegedly. Actually, where I met some very, very good friends there, actually. And so that's where I met Denard's brother. He worked there. And so I became good friends with him and Denard through that. But it's kind of funny how everything works. But I'd say that definitely for undergrad bar was the Jug. It was always like the first stop. And then you went to Rick's or, you know, Charlie's or somewhere. Wherever
can't forget about that. Cantina either.
Cantina,
that was a good spot before everything went down there. Cantina was that might have been number one for me.
It was cheap drinks, right? Cheap drinks the whole time, and it was always good music there, and kind of like a hidden spot, like kind of a low key spot. So it wasn't super packed all the time. I like Cantina a lot. But nowadays I'd say Pretzel Bell is the spot. So I know you and I have shared a few beverages at Pretzel Bell. So
couple mystery beers.
I mean, you can't beat a $2.50 mystery beer. So Pretzel Bell's it's the spot now.
Yeah, I'll have to agree with Pretzel Bell for sure. Have you, before it closed down, do you remember Rush?
Oh, yeah.
Main Street? That would have been, I mean, that was the best bar in Ann Arbor.
No, like, I don't know why.
That was, no idea.
Why would that close down? It was so good.
It was the best. Now it's some jazz bar. I haven't been there yet. Have you?
No, I haven't. But I've gone by on like a Thursday, Friday, Saturday night, and the line to get in is like around the block for the jazz bar. So, like crazy. So, I think they do like legitimate shows and stuff for jazz, which I've heard it's a very, very cool place to go check out if anybody's interested in that.
And I know that the place, I think it's the Ark or something, they have shows there too. That's like right store.
Yeah. I've seen that too. That's more, I feel like the Ark is more like theater maybe. Don't quote me on that, but I believe it is. Yeah. And then jazz is more like a true jazz club. But man, Rush was like, talk about good music, a great dance floor, and just a good vibe. I loved Rush.
And you'd walk in. So you'd walk in. I'll give everybody a visual here. You walk in. There's a bar there on your left. Long bar. Like, basically like the bar at Pretzel Bell in the basement. Yep. There's like that on your left. And then you go in. About halfway down the bar, there's an entrance. And it's like an entrance to a second bar area right over there. And like, after that, after those two bars, there's a dance floor over on the left side, and they have like booths and whatnot. But man, that was like Pretzel Bell. I've got my stuff against, like, you know, it's so hard to get a drink there. I almost feel like you're back at Skeeps trying to get a drink. You have to get like five at a time. Yeah. Where Rush, I feel like the bar was always available, and there was always the perfect amount of people in there.
I loved
Rush. Yeah, if I could bring any bar back, I would bring that back for sure.
Yeah, and yeah, I completely agree. So, all right, well, there you have it. There's our first question. So for you've got our our considerations or our suggestions for favorite restaurants and bars in Ann Arbor. If you don't like them, we're not held liable. But check them out, and you may see us there on any given Friday or Saturday night.
You may. That's for sure. All right, well, let's go to question number two. What is your favorite either Michigan game that you went to, or we can tweak it like you had said, what's your favorite Michigan memory? And it can be any sport.
So mine is easy. It's a very easy answer for me. So my cousin, some people might not know this, but my cousin actually played football at Michigan from 09 to 13. And so I went to just about every game, home or away, during that time, which was awesome experiences. Just to be, even though we weren't good, it was just like, you know, going to different stadiums and experiencing those were all awesome. But I also got some pretty great seats as well. in the player guest section. So, which this is probably a favorite memory for a lot of people, but the first night game against Notre Dame, everybody knows it, you know, Denard to Roundtree in the last, you know, 2 seconds, crazy game, first night game, unbelievable atmosphere. I was on the 50-yard line, row 3. So it was unreal. I've never experienced, you know, and I've been in those seats a few times just through those player guest seats, which was, you know, I'm so lucky to have, honestly. I would never take that for granted. But for that game, it was the first time I had been that close. And I just remember the pom-poms. We had yellow pom-poms, maize pom-poms, and everybody going crazy, you know, beating Notre Dame in itself is, you know, a huge thing for Michigan fans. But The back then, you know, at that time, we weren't beating a whole lot of people. So, and Notre Dame was actually pretty good at that time too. And Denard was just electric and coming back at the, in the last few minutes there. And then the final score was just unbelievable. I remember sitting. We never sat down for the, I don't know, the entire
That's how you watch quarter. A game.
Exactly. Yep. I wish Michigan Stadium was like that all the time with people standing.
Shame, man.
You get yelled at if you stand up in some sections of the stadium. That's another day we can talk about.
Yeah, that'll be a whole rant we get into.
We could go for an hour on that, but yeah, I just remember sitting there with my cousin, so Craig's brother, and his mom and dad, my aunt and uncle, and just hugging and high fiving, and my cousin that I was sitting with at that time, he was still in high school, but was had just committed to go play football at Boise State, where he played for 4 years. So very cool for him to at least, you know, he didn't get to come out. They're from Arizona. He didn't get to come out to watch his brother that often. So for him to come in and experience that game specifically, which is, I think, the only game he saw at Michigan Stadium, it was pretty awesome. So that for sure is my favorite game I've been to and favorite memory.
Yeah. And so I guess a couple questions on that and it's Craig, right? Craig Rowe.
Yep.
So I actually remember him coming in and playing and enjoying watching him play. Now was he, and I don't feel like I remember too many Michigan players if they weren't at least pretty talented. What was he ranked as, like, a recruit coming in? Was he like a four? I want to say he was a four star. Maybe I'm thinking of somebody else.
No, I'm pretty sure he was a four star. I couldn't tell you what his position rank or anything like that was, but he was a highly touted recruit. I mean, he held offers from pretty much everywhere. I think he ended up with almost 50, maybe 40 plus offers by the time he was done from big D1 schools. So, yeah, he was coming in a pretty big recruit. He actually went to high school at Chaparral High School in Arizona in the Phoenix area with Taylor Lewan. So they graduated together. Yep. And so I know Taylor as well. And so they they came out of high school together and came to Michigan together. So pretty cool story for those two. Craig ended up I think it actually just got beat out, but he broke the record his senior year for most games played or games started at the University of Michigan, which is I think that's a pretty dang cool.
Pretty impressive.
I mean, hundred and some years of 140 years almost of playing football at Michigan, and he was the one that started the most games. So pretty cool for his career.
Wow.
We'll hopefully have him on the podcast come maybe early, fall or something right before the season. But we can get him and ask him some questions about his time at Michigan.
Oh yeah. And I guess too, to follow up on that game, you said that you were on the 50-yard line and the third row. So yep. Would you say those were your best seats? Because for me, I kind of like to have a vantage point a little bit higher up, where I can kind of see everything. What's it like sitting that close to the field? And I'm sure being on the 50-yard line has to help, but what's that like?
I would rather be in row 20. Same, yeah. I mean, 50-yard line, you can't beat it. But I'd rather be up a little bit, probably rows 15 to 20. I will say that one, for any other game, I'd take it from row 15 to 20. For that game, I don't remember sitting down. So you have a better vantage point when you're standing up. So it was like it ended up being perfect. And I know sometimes when you get too close, especially behind the benches, it's hard to see over, 130 guys on the sideline or whatever they have. Yeah. So I agree with you 100%. I'd rather be up a little bit, but still being just that close to the action, it does make up a little bit for your vantage point as far as like seeing the game develop and things like that.
Yeah. I'm trying to, like, when you said that, it made me think, what are the best seats that I've sat in? And I'm lucky to have had the opportunity to sit up in a box. since those were put in. Some friends that work out at Orange Theory, they invited myself and Aaron up there to watch a game with them, which was pretty cool. It was actually the Iowa game this past year, so it wasn't a super entertaining game, but it was a really cool experience.
That was a big win for us.
Yeah, that was a big win at the time. I think they were both top 10, or Iowa was ranked 10th or something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
But there was one time, I don't know how this worked out, but me and my buddies were, we had some friends at the time that were Michigan alumni that came back for the game. Couldn't even tell you what game it was, but we all tailgated and pregame before. Went to the game. They were sitting in the student section, and our seats were, I think, literally right across the student section on the other side of the field. So they were like, hey, come on over, try to sit with us. So we went over to the student section, and they didn't have any seats next to them, so we couldn't get down there. But one of the aisle guys, whatever you want to call them, event staff, he came up to me. He's like, hey, how many do you have? And normally they're checking for, like, wristbands and whatnot, see if you're a student. He didn't check. So we got lucky. He was like, hey, I got four seats down in the third row.
All right.
So I was like, hell yeah, we'll take it, man.
We'll
so
go.
We went all the way down there, and our friends are way back up there. We're just waving to them from the third row. Those are some cool seats for sure. I'd have to say my favorite game or my favorite Michigan memory. I mean, I think yours is a good one. That was going to be my second choice if you would have taken this one. But 2011, man, me and Kalen went to that game where we beat Ohio State the most recent time. And nothing beats that. We beat Ohio State, especially looking back at that now. If Aaron and I went to that game this past year thinking, you know, anything could happen. But being in that environment for a win against your biggest rival, nothing like it.
Yeah. I mean, if you haven't been to a game or been to an Ohio State game, the buzz around the stadium before is just, there's something about it. There's just, I can't explain it, but you just can feel something in the air that's like, it's just different than any normal game for a Michigan-Ohio State game. And it's been, especially, you know, obviously we haven't beat them in a while, but, you know, when we're both ranked in the top 10, it's different. But, back in 2011, I was there as well, and we rushed the field afterwards. I remember being on the field after. Man, that was, you know, just good memories, even though they were had a down year. I mean, that's a, like you said, looking back on it, like, if I would have known that we weren't going to beat them since then, I would have never left the field at that point.
Never would have left.
Yeah, so that's a good one too.
And I think almost to compare it to, like, if you're a baseball fan, what I would say, even though we might not be in the running for any sort of playoff, it's like Yankees, Red Sox, ALCS, Game 7. That's what I would have to compare it to, right?
Yeah, for sure. For sure. I mean, it's like, it's just something. And I've been in Columbus for some big games, 2016 and 2018. And I've been in Ann Arbor too. And it's just, man, it's just a different feeling. I've been to Tigers, you know, Detroit Tigers playoff games. It's the same type of feeling where it's just like, people are excited. You've been waiting all year for this, you know, 364 days. And so it's something that I'm sure, you know, if you talk to SEC fans, you know, Alabama, Auburn, similar, or, you know, Florida, Georgia, I'm sure. But for us here in the Big Ten, I don't think it gets better than that.
Yeah, 100%. all right. So, while we're on game day, or go ahead.
No, go for it.
Well, I was going to say, since we're still on game day stuff and, like, kind of Michigan, I consider myself a superstitious guy. Do you have any, like, game day traditions that you do on a tradition on a regular basis?
I mean, so being the tailgate guy that I am,
this is true.
Honestly, it's as weird enough as this may sound, you know, as I'm not a player or a coach or anything, I don't sleep well ever the night before a game. I'm just like too pumped. I'm too, you know, amped to get up and get out there and stuff like that. My one game day tradition is I have a Michigan mug that I never use, but I only use on the mornings of Michigan game days. So that would be my one thing. Other than that, I mean, I'm up early and just ready to go. The preparation for a game day with a tailgate to put on is quite extensive. So Friday afternoons and nights are spent with loading my truck up and getting everything ready, the bar, the tables, the beer, the tents, the chairs, everything, and then taking it easy. And then on game days, I get up, have a nice cup of coffee out of my Go Blue mug, and we head out there. I have a couple friends that work for the university on game days, and I make sure to say hi to them before I go into the stadium every time. So that might be another one of my superstitions. How about you?
So for me, I feel like it changes every year, but throughout the year, I try to keep that same tradition going. So I know we had talked a little bit previously about the 2016 Ohio State game. So basically what me and my buddies, Kalen was there for this. So what we try to do is my apartment I was living in at the time, no, as long as we stayed at the apartment to watch a game, we were good. We won every game. So that was our thing. So Iowa, the reason we lost the Iowa game is we're watching at the apartment. Heather and a bunch of her friends were going out. Kalen went with them. Kalen went with them
the game?
At the beginning of the fourth quarter.
No, he thought we like had it or what?
I couldn't tell you. I was furious. I was sitting there. I'm like, dude, are you serious? And he leaves. He leaves and we lose. And I blamed that on him.
Now that I know that, I'm going to bring that up as much as I can to Kalen.
Please. So Iowa, that was the reason why. It's all Kalen's fault. Everybody blame him. Ohio State, we didn't wait till halftime to go get food. We went to no tie with like 5 minutes left in the first half. We were up. We were up at that point. I remember we were up, and then we came back. I think I was trying to watch it on my phone, and they fumbled, right? They fumbled on like the 1 yard line at the end of the second half, correct?
Yeah. End of the first half. Okay. Yeah.
End of the first half. And so that was number two. Florida State in the bowl game. Just wait till you hear this one. Heather's friend has a wedding. I'm that at a wedding on a Michigan bowl game is being played that night. I will give all the credit to the Sparties that were there. They all knew. It was my first time meeting all those guys, too. It's like beginning of Heather and I dating. And they all knew I was a big Michigan fan. I wasn't looking at my phone. None of my buddies texted me. Nobody said anything. So what I did is, luckily, I was able to rewatch it the next morning. And started off awful. But, man, although we lost, that was an exciting game. But, again, we lost because I was not at home watching the game in real time. So,
yeah.
2016, that was the tradition. I mean, you always got to put your game day gear on. I've got my Michigan socks now. I've got my shirt or hoodie or whatever it may be. I believe 2 years ago or last year, myself and Kalen and Kinch were trying to shotgun a beer before every game for good luck, and then we lost, and then we stopped doing that. So, I try to have one every year, but they're not super consistent.
Yeah. I have a couple of shirts that I will not – I've just thrown away because I think they're bad luck, or I've worn them when we've lost and we shouldn't have or something like that. I usually give them a couple games, my shirts, a couple games to, maybe it was just a one-time blunder or something. But if we lose two games and I'm wearing the same shirt, it's gone. So, but I honestly – the Iowa game, I was at my parents' house watching with my dad for that one, and I've never ever watched football games at my parents' house these days. And the only time I watch with my dad is when we're both at Michigan Stadium. And so that was like I went into it feeling like we weren't, like, it was just like nobody was taking it seriously, but it was one of those things that was weird. 2016 Ohio State, I'll save that story for another time. It was one of the worst days of my entire life. And actually, this past year at Wisconsin, I was at my cousin's wedding. So we lost. We just got absolutely rolled. It was a dry wedding.
Wait, hold on. Is this your cousin Craig who played at Michigan?
No.
Okay. Different. I was being like, man, you're scheduling a wedding on a game day? What are you doing?
different cousin. So, okay. But yeah, different cousin. But yeah, so I was at his wedding, not able to watch it, just checking the score and watching Wisconsin points roll in one after the other. So I'm with you on, like, if I'm not in my spot with, I don't like to watch really with people a whole lot, you know, my certain crew, but if there's like other people that I'm not really familiar with, and I just get angry. And so it doesn't go well.
I 100% agree with you there. I mean, obviously I've got my guys I watch a game with, but yeah, if there's somebody else or you're talking or you're a fan of the other team, please God, get away from me.
Yeah. Or if they like don't know football that well or something,
I'm not
like
gonna
that,
explain it to you.
They try to comment or ask questions. No, this is like there's 12 Saturdays a year, you know, 12 4-hour slots a year that are mine. I think I deserve that from to not be interrupted by everyone else. So all right, well, let's go while we'll stick with the Michigan topic here for one more, and then we can kind of veer off into something else. What is one? So Michigan, obviously known for their traditions, right? It's raised on tradition, and now it hangs its hat on that. What is one Michigan tradition that you would like to change?
That's a tough one, man. That's tough because obviously, like, we're Michigan fans. Like, we love a lot of the tradition that is a part of that program, right? So I'm gonna say, I know we said we're gonna save this for another segment, but this is partially a tradition because it happens every year. The big house is so damn quiet, and people go there to sit down and not yell. I would change that. 100%, top of my list. Nothing bothers me more. And this happens every time I'm at a game, every single time. I am either the only person trying to stand to watch a game and make some noise, I just don't understand it. If you're going to the game, help your team and like just say something. Like if you're just going to sit there and not say anything, watch it from home.
There's no reason for it. It feels like 50% of the people who go to the big house for games to not just stay at home and watch it. They would enjoy it more. They don't have to deal with the BS from everybody. I just don't understand why that population continues to come to these games if you're going to, bitch about everyone else that's trying to cheer on their team. What I really, really, really want for all of those fans, the crowd, the sit down people, the type of people that's telling other people to sit down and be quiet and be respectful and things like that. I want them to go to Columbus one time. Go to Columbus one time. Those people are ruthless and they don't sit down and they just give you all the shit in the world as an opposing fan, and they are there for their team. They're there to make a difference in the game. Our fans are there to watch with their eyeballs and nothing else, and sit on their comfy cushioned pad that they brought. I'm with you. There's nothing that bothers me more. And I've had this conversation a million times, and it's so, so frustrating. And like you said, we could rant for hours on this, but yeah, the atmosphere of Michigan Stadium, that is one tradition that could be changed. And I'll piggyback on that. This is a part of the atmosphere for anybody that's been to Michigan Stadium. On third downs, the band plays a little thing, and then we do the go, go, go. It is the least intimidating chant of all time for a third down for the crowd to get hype. Like, all right, I'm just like, go. Like, what is that? Every other school in, you know, NFL team in the world that is trying to get the crowd pumped up on third down to get a big stop and turn the ball over is playing AC/DC or like Hell's Bells, like something that's getting the crowd going nuts. We're doing some like chant that's not doing shit for anybody. Doesn't get me excited. It doesn't make anybody louder. Like, I mean, I tell you what,
I've never heard that ever. I've never heard of this third down. I don't know if it's because I'm yelling.
The reason why I know pretty much on every down or every moment of any game what the band is going to play. Part of that is because my girlfriend she literally directs them and tells them what to do. So that's a big part of it. But the other part is
figure it out.
I know. I tell her this like every day, and she's like, dude, I can't do anything about this. They've done the same thing for 100 years. But anyways, so the band goes on away games as well. And so I've been on probably, 20 away games. And so when you're on an away game, you're sitting with the band in one section. Right. So you end up doing those chants all the time. And it's just like, I think we need a little makeover on what's going on. And it starts with like the older people at Michigan Stadium thinking that it's, 1968 and we're still Big Ten champions for the 10th time in the row. And people are going to the games in their suit and ties, it's a different time now. So, I love the tradition of Michigan, but let's change things a little bit to help our team win at home, like a lot of other schools do.
Agreed. All right. So I've got one more Michigan topic that we could bring up. Do you want to do that one and then finish off with, you had brought this one up. What is one Michigan athlete that left early that you wish would have stayed?
So I think the easy answer here is Trey Burke for me. I mean, he was National Player of the Year. We were on top of the world. We had just, gone to the national championship game. I truly, if he stays, we were good in 2014 with Derek Walton for sure. If he stays and Stauskas is still there and it's just a duo with him and Stauskas, I mean, we're going back to the Final Four, I think, no doubt.
And who else stayed? Because GR3 and Tim Hardaway were on that team too. One of them left, and I think one of them stayed.
Tim left, and GR3 stayed.
Okay.
Because Tim was a junior at that point. Tim was a year ahead of Trey.
GR3 left, was a freshman, right?
Yep, GR3 stayed, for the next year. That's the easy one. I'm trying to think of any other ones. I mean, there's a multitude of other athletes that I think should have stayed, and looking back on it in 2020 vision in the past, it's like, dude, what were you even thinking? But, DPJ is one of them right now. So, there's been plenty of DPJs in the past, from Michigan too. But I mean, even, at that point, I don't blame Trey for leaving. What else could he have possibly done to up his draft stock?
Right, your stock's nothing. That high, you got to go.
Same for Stauskas the following year. One other person from that year, 2013, though, is Mitch McGarry. Our boy Mitch McGarry, who
love it.
He's having fun in bumfuck Indiana right now. Who knows what he's doing?
He's having fun. He's having fun for sure, man.
If he stays where, you know, we don't take a step back, and he for himself, still up. I mean, his draft stock was crazy high too after that tournament. I think, yeah, everybody knew, kind of, not everybody knew, but like, man, he had some growing up to do, that's for sure. So I don't know.
Yeah.
How about you?
All right. It's tough. Like, cause my person that's in my head isn't technically an athlete. He's a coach, and it's Lloyd Carr.
Okay. All right. I'll take it.
There's obvious reasons, right? That means no Rich Rod. Rich Rod never came in. But also means Ryan Mallett stayed. And that guy was he didn't do well at Michigan when for like his very small amount of time played there. But when he went to Arkansas, he blew it up, man. He played for the Patriots. I mean, he made it to the NFL. I think he was a second or third round pick as a quarterback.
Yeah.
But I mean, that could have changed the whole trajectory of Michigan football right there. If I've got to pick an athlete, I would have to say, God, man, it's a tough one. Peppers.
I was going to say Jabril too on the football side. But yeah. I mean, again, for him too, like, he was a Heisman finalist. Like, your draft stock's not going to get much higher after that. So,
no.
I understand it, but man, if those guys stay one more year, you know, I don't know. I just think guys look at the money and they see it, and I completely understand why you're going. That's your dream.
It's being thrown at you.
Yeah, and you're finally at the point where you're accomplishing your dreams, but I still think that the experience that you get in college and at the University of Michigan as a 4-year letterman, it's like you can't replicate that at any point. As soon as you go into the draft, you know, it's kind of over. And so the Lloyd Carr thing, though, you know whose fault that is that he left? It's the fans.
Michigan 100%. Fans,
you know, they pushed 100%. Him out because he couldn't deal with 9-3. And then 3 years later, we were begging for 9-3. We're 3-9.
Literally, you know, yeah.
So it's a classic case of Michigan fans thinking that we're on top of that. But
the grass
now
is greener.
I'd kill for Lloyd.
Nah.
Grass is always greener on the other side. At this point, I'd kill for, you know, Lloyd Carr and winning Big Ten championships and Rose Bowls.
100%, man.
So,
all right. Well, let's go to the, last topic. I think this is number 6. If you could pick
We've got two left.
All right. Yeah. Well, all right. I'll go this one then. If you could pick one professional athlete's life that you could live, who would you pick?
This is, I
and
mean,
you can go at, obvious. And let's say you can go at any point in time. Like, let's say,
so like at their somebody, prime too.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. This is relevant, and it's a little saucy, I'll tell you, but Dennis Rodman.
Hell yeah, dude.
Dennis Rodman.
I'm watching that that documentary. I'm like, holy shit, he dated Carmen Electra? I did not know that.
The documentary on MJ is like, has me wishing I had Dennis Rodman's life. This whole time, I thought Dennis Rodman was the weirdest guy on the planet. He's a moron. He's all this, you know, which I still, like, I'm not sure that he's not, obviously. But I'm like, I mean, this guy had Carmen Electra in her heyday. She was, I mean, that there was nobody on top of Carmen Electra back then when he had not one person. And so, like, between that and just the Vegas trips, like them being them being NBA champs, like being Michael Jordan's like best friend, basically. Like, think about how valuable you have to be to have Michael Jordan come and have to find you in Las Vegas. Like, I mean, Michael Jordan's coming to rescue somebody. Oh my God. And then, also, I mean, this is,
how are you going to be granted that time? He's like, coach, I need a vacation. Middle of the season. I'm going to Vegas.
What? Like, who gets that? There isn't a soul in the world who gets, you know, who's granted
Could
that.
Could you imagine that right now? Middle of season, for example, let's say, I mean, Klay Thompson goes to Vegas, middle of season. Social media, just being around now, oh, it'd be everywhere. You can't do that. He wouldn't be able to do it.
I mean, you wouldn't be able to do it because of social media, but, like, I mean, think about if you were – how did the newspapers not get that at the time? Or, like, media, like, whatever it was, news stations. Like, I mean, imagine if you're just some random dude in Vegas and the NBA season's going on, the Bulls are playing, and you're like, why is Dennis Rodman at the craps table next to me? Like, with three – strippers or something like that next to him. Like, what's going on, man? I'd be like double checking. It's not like Dennis Rodman can fit in anywhere. Like, he can't hide.
Yeah, his outfits are ridiculous and crazy.
His hair is dyed on
purpose. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And then you become, you know, now he's, well, who knows if Kim Jong-un is alive or dead, but he's like best friends with the dictator of North Korea. Like, I mean, talk about, you might not have the holiest life in the world, but talk about just a range of, like, from day one to, you know, wherever he's at now, he's had some experiences in his life.
That's a good one. I wouldn't have picked that one. I wasn't even, like, I'm glad you said it because it is relevant now with the documentary. But I've got a tough one. I mean, I think if it's right now, I'd have to say Patrick Mahomes, right? I mean, he was MVP 2 years ago. He won a Super Bowl last year. The dude's on top 20, of the world.
23 years old.
And he's still young. He's still so young. Like,
yep.
I have to go Pat Mahomes, 100%.
Yeah, I mean, I think that any of those guys that have such success and fame at such a young age – you know, that would be the fun time to enjoy that fame. You know, if you're, you know, once you get past that initial, like, probably 5 years as a professional athlete, then you're probably, like, so sick of, you know, fans and people loving on you and, like, girls. I mean, it's hard to say that you'd, you know, get sick of girls throwing themselves at you, but I'm sure they do, you know.
Oh, yeah.
When you can have any one of them, you'd get sick of it. So, like, at some point, it's like I think if you're, you know, at the top of your game at 30, you know, it's so much different to be able to enjoy that than he literally did it at 22, 23 years old. Like, I mean, I can't imagine that. He's kept his girl the whole time, which is phenomenal for him, but surprising to say the least. That's a good one too. Yeah. All right. So last but not least here, the sixth topic of the Saturday six pack. And this one is an NFL question. Do you think that Trevor Lawrence, the Clemson quarterback, is an absolute lock even before the 2020 college football season for the number one pick in the NFL draft next year? Or does Justin Fields, the Ohio State quarterback, can he make a push?
I'm going to say that anybody can make a push. I don't think it's Trevor Lawrence's lock at all. And the biggest reason for that is a lot of people were coming out this time last year saying Jake Fromm was going to be the number one overall pick last year. And he was he was drafted, right? Like, was he drafted?
Yeah, but he was late. Quarterback off the board.
Right. So for that reason, I would say it's anybody's, you know, opportunity. I mean, nobody expected Joe Burrow, right? Come out of nowhere, be the number one overall pick. So I'm going to say no. I mean, honestly, Trevor Lawrence is probably going to be the number one pick, but anybody could take it. I mean, that dude's a stud. Honestly, if I was him, I would just sit out the whole year.
Well,
you
and that's
can do
what,
nothing but hurt yourself.
That's what they said. So he, you know, as a freshman, a true freshman, I believe, I don't think he redshirted. I'm pretty sure he was a true freshman. Mm-hmm. He, you know, led Clemson to a national championship, right?
Yeah.
And there were a lot of people that said, all right, your draft stock's not going to get any higher. You should sit out for two straight years and then go to the NFL. So obviously he didn't do that. Clemson still did pretty dang good there. Yeah. It turned out well, but he didn't have the near the season that he did, you know, his freshman year last year. So there was a little bit of downturn from that, but I still think, you know, with the body he has, what is he, 6'6", you know, can run,
lanky,
agile,
good arm,
extremely good arm. You know, he's got every tool that an NFL scout is looking for. And, you know, when you see him on the big stage at 19 years old and thriving, you know, it's hard to say that there is some, you know, anything there that could stop him from, you know, excelling at the NFL level. But I still think, you know, you look at Justin Fields, we've talked about it. He's obviously our arch nemesis, but 40 touchdowns and one interception, you know, in an offense where they throw the ball a ton, you know, the fact that he just never really threw it into trouble is where I'd be like, all right, maybe I want that guy. Because, you know, as a top five pick, you're going to a team that probably has offensive line struggles. They're, you know, not going to – they're a bottom five team, obviously. I'd say, you know, he's definitely got a shot at it because he – the other part of it is – in today's NFL, you know, he runs just as good as he throws, and he runs on, or he throws on the run. You know, more Trevor Lawrence, even though he is athletic and can run, he's not a guy that's going to go side to side and, you know, shake some people off in the backfield, where Justin Fields is that guy. And he's not 6'6", but he's much more mobile. I think it's, you know, it hurts me to say that because, God, I wish he would sit out and go to the NFL next year because he's so dang good as the Ohio State quarterback. But, I mean, they will probably go one, you know, 1-2 or 1-3 or something like that, you know, whoever needs a quarterback. But I agree with you, you know, and maybe there's somebody else who comes out, like you said. Nobody had Joe Burrow in their top 50. Joe Milton
2020.
Joe Milton's coming out as the top. If let's see, what do I have to do if Joe Milton is the 2021 number one NFL draft pick? Man, I don't even know what I'll do, but I commit to doing something absolutely ridiculous. But hey, you know what? If Joe Milton's the number one 2021 draft pick, that means we as a Michigan team did phenomenal. You know, we found our guy. So I'd take it. So that's funny, though. So, all right. Well, there you go. So that is our Saturday six pack. I hope you guys enjoyed it. We'll continue to do this, and like Jack said, it won't be just me and Jack. It'll be, you know, any one of us four here. We may even have some other guests on, you know. So we'll see what happens with this. If you liked it, let us know. If you have any questions or topics that you'd like us to discuss, we'd love to hear them. We'd love to talk about what you guys want to hear about. So thanks for listening. Cheers. We'll have a couple more beverages here after the show, and we'll talk to you guys soon.
Go Blue.
Go Blue.